Welcome to the EMBL webinar series on lifelong learning in the biomedical sciences. My name is Claire Johnson and I work at EMBL's European Bioinformatics Institute in the training team. Today's webinar is The Role of Learning to Support Digital Transformation in Pharma, presented by Simon Brown, Chief Learning Officer at Novartis. Okay, so this webinar is part of the second series of the EMBL webinars of lifelong learning in the biomedical sciences. This webinar will be the final one in this series. If you would like to hear this and any other webinars from both the first and the second series, you can find the links to all the recordings from the webinar series homepage. So I'd like to take this chance to thank my co-organisers of the two webinar series for their ideas and insight, which have enabled us to choose topics that are of interest and relevance to our audience and to select a great set of speakers. So they are Mike Hardman, who was Vice President of Innovative Medicine Initiative Collaborations at AstraZeneca and has continued to put time and effort into the webinars following his retirement. Christy Yanko, he is Director of Academy Programs and Strategy at the Vienna Academy for Workforce Competence in Clinical Research, that's VIARIS. And Linda White, who is Executive Director at TOPRA, the Organisation for Professionals in Regulatory Affairs, and Kath Brooksbank, who is head of the training team at EMBL's European Bioinformatics Institute. I'd also like to mention Wolf C, who has worked for many years in biohealthcare and has also contributed to the webinar series. Currently, there are no plans for a third series. However, if you'd like to voice your support for further webinars and share the topics that are of interest and importance to you, please do so either through the survey at the end of the webinar or via our mailing list, and I encourage you to sign up for the mailing list, and that's shown on screen here and is from the webinar website as well. Okay, so moving on to today's webinar, I'm delighted to have such a great speaker, Simon Brown, for this last webinar. We've had the highest number of registrants of this series, which reflects both Simon's reputation and the interest in the topic. Simon is very familiar with the lifelong learning in the biomedical sciences concept, being one of the speakers for the EMBL conference in 2016 that sparked this webinar series. Simon Brown has a prestigious career history in corporate learning and capability building. Simon co-founded Brightwave, one of the UK's leading e-learning companies, moving on to Accenture to consult for companies including BT, BP, Microsoft and Canon. He then focused on the banking industry, working with Barclays, HSBC and RBS. At Lloyds Banking Group, he led a successful enterprise-wide learning transformation, including a new learning operating model, process and technology platforms, overhaul of the learning curriculum and learning blend, increasing the volume of and engagement with learning. In 2013, Simon moved to Novartis Global Headquarters in Switzerland to set up the learning team and the Capability Building Academy, responsible for enhancing effectiveness of learning for the global pharma sales force and commercial business. In 2016, he moved to the development world and created the cross-divisional Global Development University before progressing in September 2017 to take over the Novartis-wide Learning Centre of Excellence and Novartis Universities, and also define the strategy for digital capability building. In February of this year, Simon was appointed Chief Learning Officer at Novartis. His responsibilities include leading learning and capability building across the company, defining and implementing the Novartis learning strategy and building digital capability. Simon's awards include an honorable mention as Learning Champion of the Year, the Chief Learning Officer Silver Strategy Award, and also an HR Excellence Award. So thank you very much, Simon, and I'll hand over the presentation to you.
Thank you very much, Claire. I hope you can all hear me and the webcam's coming through okay. And in a moment, I will also share my slides with you as well. So you should be able to see the presentation as well. So thrilled to be talking to you all today. I'll spend the next half an hour or so sharing with you some of the story from the last year or so at Novartis of how the learning function has supported our digital transformation. At the end, we should have time for questions, so please do store up your questions and we'll try and address as many of those as time permits. Feel free to use the text chat as well as the questions come up, and we'll look to address those at the end. So firstly, let me introduce you to Novartis if you're not familiar with us as a company. So we're a focused medicines company. Our products are sold in 155 countries around the world. And last year we touched over 800 million patients, and 24 million of those are through our access programs, which allow access to healthcare for people who may not be able to otherwise afford. So we have about 100,000 associates around the world, and we had just over 50 billion turnover last year. So a fairly sizable company with a large workforce. Our purpose as a company is to reimagine medicine to improve and extend people's lives. And we do that through our culture, which we've recently revisited. And our culture is defined as inspired, curious, and unbossed. Curious is fantastic, being in a role in learning, to have a company where the culture is defined by being curious. In terms of our strategy and our five strategic pillars, unleashing the power of our people is our number one priority, and a lot of things that you're going to hear today align to that vision around unleashing the power of our people, as well as one of our priorities around going big on data and digital, of which a lot of today's presentation is around how do we build those skills in data science, in digital, and I'll share with you what we've been doing, what worked, some of the things that didn't work, and maybe some things there that can work for you. So maybe let's step back to what prompted the need for us to look at building digital capability. So if we go back to end of 2017, we were looking as a company at the strategy going forward, and we identified that digital is going to be increasingly important. And some of the research at the time was telling us that when we look at digital, the number one thing that people are identifying as a top concern regarding digitalization is the need for better upskilling. And what we see on the slide here from Gartner Corporate Executive Board is over 52% of people cited that better upskilling around digital was that top concern. What we also see at the same time is an acceleration in terms of skills. We see that there are new skills appearing. So a third of employees have learned a new to world skill in the last 3 years. And by a new to world skill, we mean something that didn't exist 3 years ago. So examples could be something like robotic process automation, to some extent data science. These didn't exist in the form that they exist today 3 years ago. And a third of people have learned those in the last 3 years. At the other end of the spectrum, nearly 20% of the skills that people have today that they feel will be irrelevant within 3 years' time. So you get this mix between new skills appearing and the skills that people have today expiring, and therefore the need for really strong learning, upskilling, and particularly in the area of digital, becomes increasingly important. And those are some of the principles that have defined the learning strategy and how we're moving forward as a company. What that led us to look at with regards to digital is how do we build then that digital capability across a pharma company? And we first off started looking at who needs what in terms of that digital capability building. What we saw was that there were three distinct audiences that we could break down the needs into. One of those audiences is around leaders. So what do our leaders need in terms of an understanding around digital, in terms of how they can incorporate digital into their strategy, and in terms of how do they set the right culture, the right environment for people to be successful around digital, encouraging innovation, encouraging experimentation, dealing well with failure and accepting that as a key part of innovation. So it's a key set of skills that our leaders need. Secondly, then, is around practitioners. So these are the people who are actively involved in digital projects, and they need deep digital skills in areas like data science, blockchain, robotic process automation, much, much deeper skills because they're actively involved in those projects. And how do we build those skills and those specialist skills around data and digital? And then the third group is around all of our associates, so the 100,000 people around the world. If our chief digital officer or the CEO is talking about why digital is so important for the company, what do we mean by digital? What does it actually, what does it entail? What's included? What's not included? How do we demystify what digital actually is? And so there's a need there of raising that awareness for all associates in terms of what we're talking about when we talk about digital. And then there are various pieces that underpin that in terms of a culture of learning, skills frameworks, etc., that we also needed to put in place. And what I'll do is take you through the different solutions that we created for each of these and some of the learnings that we had, the things that worked, the things that didn't, so that you can benefit from that experience. For our leaders, we came up with something that we call our digital immersion for leaders, and that's a 3 or 4 hour hands-on playing with different digital technologies and making a series of leadership decisions, and we'll go into that in more detail. For our practitioners, we came up with a range of solutions, including communities of practice that had curated learning paths, including access to leading e-learning to build skills at both a broad level and a focused detailed level. Access to MOOCs, to massive open online courses, to build skills at a really deep level, and access to knowledge sharing platforms as well. And then we had some specific offerings in certain parts of our business where we could dive deeper into needs, where based on data and digital in drug development, or based on what it means in our commercial and Salesforce area, where there may be more specific things around digital that we need to do. So that was for our practitioners. And then if we look at the awareness for all associates, there we came up with a solution that we called our Digital Awareness Hub, as well as giving them access to broader e-learning and also some of the communities of practice and other things that were available to practitioners as well. So different solutions targeted on the different audiences and building skills out to a different level. Those then were staggered over the course of 2018, and our focus today is talk mainly on what we did through 2018, so I can share then the pieces that worked and that didn't. But we had staggered over the course of the year different things going live at different points, and I'll walk you through those. So let's start with the Digital Awareness Hub. So the goal of the Digital Awareness Hub was to demystify digital for all associates. So when we talk about digital, what is it? What does it mean for different parts of the business? What does it mean for us as Novartis versus maybe what it's more generally meaning out in the marketplace? And for this, we built the Digital Awareness Hub. It's a video-based platform that has probably 2 to 3 hours worth of video content on there and some reading that goes with that. A lot of that was created internally in terms of using Novartis people to talk about what digital means for Novartis, but some of it was also embedding external content that may be things on YouTube or outside that was great content that we didn't need to recreate. We could just reuse content that existed out there. And the goal to learn about the digital strategy, learn around what digital means for Novartis, what it means for patients and for the doctors that we interact with. And through working through the hub, you could then learn about the different areas, undertake quizzes, and actually work through and earn digital badges. And there were 6 different badges as you went through. And if you got all 6, you then earned your Digital Champions badge, which was a sign that you'd understood everything across the site and understood the different projects and different things that were going on. And we made this site available in 100 languages using Google Translate, as well as some manual translation in there to make it available to everyone all around the world. This is what some of the different pages looked like. So it covered different areas of our business around innovation, around the operations, around how we engage with our customers, with doctors or with patients, around how we power digital through both technology and through culture, and then also links out to communities of practice, which we'll come on to talk about in a moment. It had personalized recommendations. So based upon your interests, you could personalize the site, promoted events and new material, and then you had the progress tracking against your badges where you could see areas that you hadn't covered in there in order to make sure that you had covered all the material to then go and take the quizzes and earn your badges. You could bookmark things as you went, and you had the ability to personalize it based upon the areas that were of most of interest to you. Through that personalization, it then recommended things that would be relevant. As I said, we then also had the translation in there, so to try and make it as accessible to our associates who are based all around the world, and not all of them have English as the first language, so we had the ability to translate all of the text in there, and for key languages we also subtitled the videos to make that more accessible. And then one of the key features in here was the badges, and the badges proved really popular in terms of encouraging people to work through, and also once people are in and had earned a badge, to then continue on to get more of the badges and ultimately earn the Digital Champions badge. And we found people getting really excited about the Digital Champions badge, posting it on our internal social media, adding it into their email footers. It created quite a buzz in terms of people wanting to get those digital champions badges. And in various parts of the organization, we also ran competitions to see how many people could get them. Giving you the data in terms of the stats on this, so we're now a year on since we launched this. It's a voluntary training program, essentially, a voluntary learning resource. A year on, we've had 24,000 people go through and access the material and work through that. On average, they spent about half an hour per person. So there's multiple sessions per person, an average session being about 11 minutes. So it's around about half an hour on average across 24,000 people. Nearly 500,000 page views. And in terms of those badges that I mentioned, so nearly 15,000 badges have now been awarded. And we've got 1,700 digital champions who have gone all the way through and all of their badges and become a digital champion. And that's then from people all around the world. You see from the map here, we've got all across the world that people have been partaking in this. We were able to see which countries had the top engagement. So India had, based on badges, the top level of engagement, followed by Switzerland, where our head office is. So we're able to sort of track across the countries to see, you know, where have we got the strongest engagement. We're able to see, you know, how people have accessed it and where over time people accessed it. And what we saw was through some of our promotions. So we had a launch of this in a company-wide town hall where we can see there was a real spike of activity of people coming in. I think we had about 8,000 people access and nearly 350 badges off the back of a launch in the town hall. We also have a company-wide learning month that we did in September last year, and we see a really heavy spike of badges where people were getting engaged with it through some competitions that we ran within that learning month. Those were the things that went well. We also got a load of feedback from it of areas that we could improve. We actively sought through the site to get feedback of, you know, what works for you, what doesn't work for you. We were able to correlate all of those feedbacks down. So, you know, loads of positive comments, which is great, but more importantly probably is what are the things that we need to improve for the future. So we had lots of content suggestions. You know, it'd be great if we could include something on this, or maybe we could get more detail on that. We had some challenges in certain parts of the world and things like video. We had suggestions on, you know, videos are too long, also some suggestions videos too short. So it's one of those, if you've got 24,000 people going through, maybe not everyone is always happy with exactly what you got, but it's really helpful for us to be able to look through this and see, you know, where are things as we update this and refine this that we need to improve it over time. In terms of some of the lessons learnt from it, so I think one of the big things we learnt was around being courageous of actually launching it before it was fully ready. So we launched it to a pilot audience back in March last year, about 1,000 people, which included the top 300 people in the company, which we wanted them to hear about it before everybody else. And then we've selected a number of people who'd either been involved in its development or were sort of key stakeholders. And we launched it to them in beta. We had a lot of discussion of, is it okay to launch it in beta? And when I say that, it means that certain things were still undergoing approval. Maybe there was bits missing in certain places. Maybe some of the videos weren't the final ones. But what we felt was, you know, let's take the plunge. Let's be courageous. Let's get it out there. People can then give us feedback on what's working and what's not before we then launch it to everybody. With hindsight, that was the right decision. Going into that, it was quite a tough decision to take, to say, actually, we're going to put something out there that's not quite perfect and not quite, you know, everything as it should be. But I think in retrospect, it was the right thing to do. Here, second one around push for the wow. So we had a lot of earlier versions of this that didn't quite hit the mark in terms of either the visuals or wasn't quite as impressive of who wanted. A lot of the discussions around what could we use in terms of branding and things based on our brand guidelines. That took a lot of work to work through, but the end result was better for trying to sort of get it as much of a wow as possible in there. I think we learned from the badges. This is the first time we've really done something enterprise-wide around badges, and really surprised, pleasantly surprised around how the badges really got traction and how people embraced the working through the badges to get their digital champions badge, and how those badges then, you know, got shared elsewhere. So I think that surprised us at how well those really work. And the use of competitions, whether it's to have countries against each other so you can get the most badges, or whether it's in a particular country. India did a fantastic campaign with their sales force around, you know, who could get their digital champions badge, and led to a massive growth of digital champions there. So use of some competitions with local managers and leaders to drive that adoption was really powerful. as well as the use of social media. And we saw, you know, the links to it, the promotion of it go viral across the social media, as well as people, you know, sharing their achievements through the badges as well. I think the endorsement from senior leadership, and I cite the town hall here, where we see, you know, a mention from the CEO in an enterprise town hall, and you get this massive spike in uptake. So I think that was a great way to launch it, and that, you know, our leaders promoting it was a really good way to keep traction with it. But we also see, you know, where we do those spikes, we get fantastic traction. And, you know, there's then good traction throughout, but you can really make a difference with that traction. And we need to then keep that communication going as well to keep the uptake going. And we're aiming for 50,000 by the end of this year. So there's a lot of traction we need to get over the next 6 to 9 months in order to get the usage up to where our goal is by the end of this year. I mentioned we have it in 100 languages. You know, that's a great thing to be able to say, but not all of the translations across those 100 are quite as perfect as one would like to think. So, you know, generally it does the job. I think some of those, though, it's not perfect, certainly, and it may be far from perfect for some of those languages. Better than not having anything at all, but there's still some way for that auto translation to go to be giving you a fantastic translation for everybody. And the final point on here, final lesson I think we learned from it, is around sometimes actually who owns some of these topics around digital can be really difficult. And the one that we struggled in particular with was around agile working. So, you know, who's the owner in the business of agile working? Is it IT? Is it a way of working, so it's more in HR? Or is it a particular part in the digital team? And getting that clarity around, you know, who really is the right person to say what this really means, we found very difficult. So it's a few lessons learned there. Hopefully that's helpful if you come to do a similar project to this. And go on and share some of the other solutions that we have as well. So I mentioned we have the different audiences. So one of the other solutions was a digital immersion for leaders. So this is targeted our managers and leaders, so people who lead people or lead teams around the world. The goal we have for this year is to put 4,000 of our managers and leaders through this program. We have about 1,000 at the moment. Proved a very challenging one to create because a lot of the things we were doing were moving as we go. The format of this is a 3 to 4 hour session that you run as a team. So the team comes together physically together, and you work through a scenario where in pairs you make a series of decisions based on information that you're given. You get to play with some of the different digital tools that we have. It might be going in and figuring out how to come up with a population for a clinical trial, or it may be looking at social media data and determining, you know, what can you do based on this social media listening. A range of different technologies around digital that you really get to play with, understand, and then make a series of decisions, as well as leadership decisions around, for example, you know, the team tried something, it failed, you know, what do you do? Do you penalize them? Do you encourage them to try again? You know, how do you deal with those things? It became clear very quickly that we needed tailored scenarios for different areas, that one scenario wouldn't fit for the whole business. We have very different parts of our business between manufacturing or our scientists who do the research and development, or our sales force and our commercial business that are out there talking to doctors around our different medicines, or centrally in a finance role or an HR role or a procurement role, etc. So very different business areas, and therefore different scenarios that we needed to build to cater for that. And that was one of the challenges I think we saw. The sessions would be facilitated by a champion, and people get to play, experiment as they go through. There's a bit of a gamification element in there, and it supports our culture in terms of the types of decisions. And I mentioned, for example, unboss as a part of our culture. So this is around, you know, how does the leader help to actually remove blockages for the team and support what the team's doing versus telling them exactly what to do. That supports the principle around unboss. This was, I think, in terms of the lessons learned for this, I think the first and foremost that this is a hard area to build sophisticated learning for. The video side of things for the Digital Awareness Hub was relatively easy. You record a video, if it goes out of date, you record another one. Whereas for this to build a fairly complex scenario that has to hang together across a whole series of different questions and interactions with the use of digital tools is really hard. it's probably one of the hardest projects I've had to do in my career, I would say, just because the speed of change is so fast. The people you're trying to work with, everyone wants to be needing access to them because the digital is the hot topic at the moment. So getting time in their diaries is really hard. Getting them to spend, you know, decent time to actually be able to work through and review things and give the information, really difficult. So I found this was a very challenging area. One of the things I think is to prototype early. So we absolutely did that. We prototyped it very early, and iterating frequently was often because when different people saw that prototype, you then get feedback that certain things don't work and you need to iterate and change. And we went through quite a few of those iterations, and sometimes pretty major iterations where we thought we had something pretty finished, and then a different group saw it and actually, no, we weren't able to go with certain things and we needed to quickly change and adapt. So being prepared to change is great. Getting that prototype out there early so people can see what it really looks like is great, but that also makes it difficult if you're having to be iterating very frequently. High quality facilitation became critical. We changed a bit our approach to facilitation from our original ideas to where we're going to, or where we, how we're doing it now, and more in our sort of train the trainer of facilitators versus how we did it. And I think being prepared to flex our approach to meet user feedback, so decide, you know, and really listening to the end users, what works for them, what doesn't, and adapting it. Those would be some of the things I think, you know, if we're doing it over, those would definitely lessons that we could learn from what we've done. Next up, communities of practice. So here the idea was we have people who are expert in different areas around digital, but they're often dispersed right around the world, different parts of the company, and there wasn't historically an easy way to bring those people together. So we figured if we can create communities of practice, so places where people can come together to be able to share things of interest around a topic, find each other, have conversations, also get access to learning and news relating to that topic, there would be a great value in bringing people together. So we created a series of communities of practice. You see them on here, things like blockchain, Internet of Things, data science. For those, we had learning paths, and those were paths at different levels. So you'd have a fundamental, an intermediate, an advanced, and a thought leader one. So depending on whether you were new to the area or you were already expert at it, there would be different resources available. There would be a Yammer community, so a social media community that you could use to share and contact each other, news feeds, links to resources, identifying who the experts are in those different areas, etc. In terms of success, I would say they've had mixed success. So here you can see tracking over the course of last year from when we launched, where we saw really, really strong engagement through to then much lower engagement as time went on. It's still potentially 50 to 100 people accessing them on a regular basis, but not anywhere near the level that we had of several hundred at the start. I think part of that was probably us not updating the content and continuing to promote them as well as maybe we could do, that we got diverted into other things. So I think there's value in having the communities of practice, but there's definitely, I think, ways certainly we could have done better around how we promoted those and how we updated them. I think in terms of the lessons we could learn from that, if you're not constantly adding content to them, why do people come back? So I think we needed to make them stickier. We needed to get more content in, and that's something we'll be looking at in the future. We did lots of promotion at the start. We linked them from the Digital Awareness Hub, but maybe there's more we could do around promotion. I think promotion via high traffic pages pays off. So if we look here, the two highest ones were on the landing page in the Digital Awareness Hub that we looked at earlier. So when you came into that hub to get your badges, you would have a link from the landing page, and hence we see nearly 1,000 people access the design thinking community of practice. So it really helps if you can put links to them in places where there's high traffic. And I think what we didn't do so well was having people who actively, as part of their role, they were community managers and really driving the content. So if anyone else is thinking of setting these up, maybe that's something to think about in how you do it. Some of the other resources available. So we gave access to e-learning, range of e-learning, and still giving access to a range of e-learning around digital, whether that's broadly around digital transformation, as we see here through some of our Skillsoft content, whether that's much deeper in terms of things like the skills needed for data science, so things like Python or Spotfire, or whether that's on data visualization through things like Tableau, or ways of working with Agile with things like Scrum. So these were much more technical for the practitioners to be able to dive in and build their skills and learn more. And some of this stuff you'll be able to find externally. So if you're not part of a large organization, some of this learning may be available externally, either free or on demand as well. What we saw, if we go back to the Digital Awareness Hub, was that there was a spike in September of 2018. And that was when we had an enterprise-wide learning month where we took a 4 weeks to promote learning across the whole company with a series of webinars, activities that were open to everybody. And in there, we had a week dedicated specifically to digital and building skills around digital. And hence, we saw the spike in terms of the hub, the badges that went with that. But we also had a real range of digital webinars to promote all of the different resources available, to deep dive into how digital is used, for example, in clinical trials, and really to promote learning around digital and curiosity in general. In terms of a concept, so we had in total about 15,000 people accessing the webinars across both centrally and locally organized webinars and local events. We had, I think, close to over 100 different sessions conducted over that 4 week period, either physical events in a country or global events through webinars. And in total, over 50,000 learning hours that were conducted from about 15,000 people that took part, and with a mix of internal and external presenters. Essentially, this was a zero cost initiative. So we were using existing webinar technology, we were using internal presenters or external partners who were already working with us to present. So we were essentially able to do over 50,000 learning hours to 15,000 people without any significant cost to the company. So if you find your budgets are challenged, which many of us do, then this was a great initiative where without a great investment, you'll be able to get really good learning to large numbers of people all around the world. Some of the things that we learned from that, so there was fantastic engagement, real excitement around learning as we rolled this out across the company. We used social media, Yammer, to be able to promote a lot of the different things, both in groups that were accessed to everyone globally, but also much more in sort of focus groups of particular business units or particular geographies to really be able to promote. And the mix of local events and global events worked well. Some of the local events were done in local language. We had sessions in Moscow, for example, that were run in Russia. And then we had things all around the world in different countries. We toyed with, is a month too long? Should we make this a week? Should we make this a day? We went with a month in the end, and actually it worked pretty well, because if you're off on holiday or you're busy period, a month is long enough that most people are able to find at least something over that 4 week period that would be relevant to them and work for their diary. We had to flex to keep up with demand. So we had several sessions that were fully subscribed. I think we were doing 250 people maximum in a session. And we had several where we had to put on more. I think we had over 1,000 people in our key sessions over multiple different iterations of it. We didn't do as well as we could have around reusing materials. So I think doing this again, we'd probably try and create materials centrally that can then be taken by people and reused and adapted for local purposes. I think we could have probably done better at that. If you plan to record them, then you can get great reuse. We didn't do that for all of our sessions. Again, I think we could probably get better at doing that, because that way, 50 to 100 sessions, that's some great material that can be reused then and people can access on demand afterwards. To my earlier point, doesn't have to be expensive. This was essentially a no-cost exercise. And the final point, test and test again, brings back memories of the launch event of it, where it was ready to broadcast to the world around this fantastic 4 weeks of activity that we had. The technology failed us, and I was sat there talking to myself in a room in Switzerland with people in rooms all around the world ready to hear about all we had in store, and the technology completely failed us. So even when you test it, and we had tested it, it still failed. So, you know, the more to be certain that the conditions are right, the technology is going to work. I mean, everyone has things that don't work, but that was very embarrassing to have the launch event to not actually reach the intended audience. And the teams did a great job of covering that in their local sessions around the world. Nearing the end now, and then we'll be able to pause for questions. So another piece that we've added through here, and this was a recent addition, is access to MOOCs, or massive open online courses. So we're just in the process this week of actually launching access to Coursera within Novartis, so that all associates get access to 4,000 university certificates from 190 universities around the world. So that gives a much deeper ability to build skills in different digital areas. It's between sort of 4 and 10 week programs certified by a leading global university in order to build out those skills at a deeper level. And for our digital champions, so again, we go back to the Digital Awareness Hub. We had those 1,700 people that had worked through and got all of their badges and become a digital champion. We're now offering them, paid by the company, access to a 300 to 400 hour massive open online course to reskill as a data scientist. So the company will pay for people to spend that time to be able to go through and build their skills to reskill as a data scientist and have those in demand skills. So those are some of the deeper learning that we're also providing access to. So that gave a flavour of some of the things that we've been doing, how the learning organisation has been supporting that journey of digital transformation across the 100,000 people that we have around the world within Novartis. I hope that's been helpful. We have now 20 minutes that we can use, I believe, for questions. So I will pause there, and maybe Claire, you can share any questions as we come. I think the suggestion is we use the chat to go through any questions. I also have with me in the room here Guy Dickinson, who's our current lead for the digital capability building. He's taken over a lot of this work and is moving it all forward. So if there's questions that I can't answer, Guy will also be here to help with those as well.
Thank you very much, Simon. Thank you. Yes, so questions can be submitted, but through the question box. And some people have already started to do that, so that's great. I kind of just wanted to finish to say how impressive I think the time and the commitment Novartis has clearly made to this, because when budgets are cut, training is often one of the first things to take the hit. So clearly here there's a real and lasting commitment, and it's great to see an organisation actually doing that. So thank you. Let me start with some of the questions. So perhaps, Simon, sorry, you could forward to the next slide. So the question slide.
Absolutely.
Just remind there.
Let me do it. Yep, there we go.
It's just a slide as well, but shows people to use the question box. So one question is, you've partially touched on it, but as you could explain, how are you measuring the success of this?
Yeah, great question. So, I mean, ultimately, the measure will be, do we have the right digital skills within the company to be able to deliver against what we're doing? So, for example, we have a series of what we call lighthouse projects, which are sort of key flagship projects around digital. And, you know, do we have the skills that we need in order to support across those projects in order to make them successful? And going forward in the future, you saw that data and digital is a key part of our strategy. So, you know, do we have the right skills in order to be able to do that, and how much do we need to buy those in versus building them ourselves? So the ultimate measure is, you know, will we be successful in providing the right skills to deliver that? That's a very general answer. There's then much more specific measures that we're looking at, which is why we have analytics behind some of these platforms, in terms of, you know, are we progressing against our targets? So, you know, at a high level, you know, are people accessing the resources? So that's the 24,000 people, for example, that are accessing the Digital Awareness Hub. You know, are they engaging and learning from those resources? So that's the 14,000 people that have been through and earned badges, which means that they've passed quizzes demonstrating their understanding of the knowledge, and the 1,700 digital champions that have gone through and fully done that. And then on some of the other ones, things like the digital awareness for leaders, you know, are we getting our leaders going through that and what's the feedback we're getting from those leaders in terms of it providing them what they need to be able to change their skill sets and things. So a range of different measures depending upon what the initiative is, who it's targeting, and what levers there are, I guess, that we can use to track it.
And kind of following on from this, how do you avoid digital training being only a box checking exercise? So I guess it's about how do you measure this translated into work? You see people doing the courses, but what does that mean actually to the day-to-day work? And I guess the obvious outcomes, that the goals that Novartis are aiming for.
Yeah, so I mean, the box ticking one, the hub is a good example of that. So we didn't in any way mandate for anyone to use the hub. So it wasn't like our traditional compliance training where you get, you know, here's the invitation to do it and here's the reminder to say you haven't done it. And if you haven't done it, we'll escalate this to your manager. It was put out there as a entirely optional piece of learning that if you want to build your digital awareness, this is available for you to do it. And 24,000 people took us up on that offer, and they invested on average nearly 30 minutes of their time in order to go through it. So I would see that for me is an example. It's not a box ticking exercise of someone just telling you have to do it. It's the curiosity of our associates around the world wanting to understand what digital is, what it means for them, and how it applies to the company. And are they investing their time, significant amounts of time, in order to be able to go through and do it. So I think that for me is what moves it away from the box ticking piece to people actually being hungry to want to learn about this and want to do it. Another example would be the data science MOOC that I referenced, where it was 300 to 400 hours of learning. So we've had over 100 people either express an interest or sign up for that from our digital champions. And that's a massive commitment of time. 300 to 400 hours is potentially something that could take you a year or two or several years to actually go through and learn and reskill around a data scientist. There's no one saying you have to do this, no one forcing you to do it, but those 100 people out of 1700 want to be building their skills in the area of data science, and therefore, you know, express an interest, and we will support them as a company. So a lot of this, I think, is pull, is the natural curiosity of our associates versus anything where the company is saying you have to be doing this, and it becomes a box ticking exercise.
And actually following on, is there an expectation this can be done within their normal working hours or in their own time? Or how's it recorded if it is internal?
Yeah, so watch this space on that one, because we will be announcing something later in the year in terms of the company's support for time to learn. So at the moment, people can do some on work time, some are fitted in around or whatever, but we're looking to be announcing something later in the year in terms of our commitment and support for giving people the time to really be able to learn and invest in building their skills. I don't want to spoil the announcement, so I won't say any more than that, but leave it to your curiosity.
Okay, a couple of questions I read out that are related, that are similar questions. So did you build this internally or work with external partners?
Yeah, so I mean the whole suite, I guess, of solutions is a mixture between things that we've done internally and things where we've worked with partners in order to bring it in. So the Digital Awareness Hub was built with a partner, but using internal subject experts, and the videos were all of internal people talking about what digital means. Also, associates from around the world sharing what digital means for them and things. So that was very much the voice of internal, but with an external partner to help us on the technology to build it and do the videoing piece. For some of the e-learning, that's, you know, generic off-the-shelf e-learning that we've incorporated and curated and pointing people towards the things that are valuable. For the communities of practice, that was our internal IT teams that built those in SharePoint. So using some of the functionality that exists there around SharePoint communities. The digital immersion for leaders was in partnership with an external vendor who's a specialist in sort of simulations and scenarios, and then working with our internal SMEs as well. So depending upon the solution, some of the things we built ourselves where it was specific messages around how Novartis interprets digital or how we want our associates to be behaving in a specific way in line with our culture. But wherever possible, we try and use, you know, external content that exists, so we don't have to recreate it and reinvent it. If there's something out there that does it well enough, then let's use that rather than rebuild it ourselves.
Thank you. So can you share the trade-off between translating, so this goes back to the languages, translating the digital content or providing it in English only? So this participant says it's great to make materials accessible, but it's a lot of work. Perhaps the smaller groups, you translating materials or even this through social media posts?
Yeah, so for the, if we look at the digital awareness hub, so for that we had it, the core thing was built in English. We then translated all of the text and the videos, translated in terms of subtitles, into, from memory, Spanish, French and German. And then we used Google Translate to translate all of the text into then these 100 other languages. So it, there was the cost of the manual translation and the subtitling for, if you like, the largest audience languages. And then beyond that, there was still availability for people through the automatic translation. But if you do manual translation down to 100 languages or whatever, the costs are ridiculous. So this felt like a good compromise, where we had a solution that met the needs of everybody, wasn't perfect, but it met the needs that everybody would be able to access it. And for the highest populations, more effort was put in terms of the manual translation part of it.
Okay, here's a really nice question. Is there an obvious difference in engagement, curiosity, and adoption across age groups and gender?
That's a great question, and I don't know the answer. So we had a difference in adoption definitely for across countries, and I think somewhere in here I have a bit of an indication. Yeah, so around in terms of country engagement. So we saw, for example, India, there was a huge traction, huge engagement. But then probably more consistent engagement, I would say, across other countries. We didn't do the analysis by gender or by age, so I don't know what the split is of that. But yeah, we certainly got the differences around geographical engagement. Yeah, I don't think we have any broader split of it based on that. I would be interested to know that split, but I'm not sure whether we have the data in order to be able to get that.
Yeah, you've got to capture the data, I guess, first. Yeah.
Yeah.
So thinking about this for people kind of which wider, perhaps PhDs or postdocs that are on the line as well, is it possible to learn a new skill such as coding, programming, all by yourself during one's studies? And if so, what is the best and fastest way? You got any comments on that?
Yeah. So I would say yes, from our experience. But the some of the solutions available maybe provide a good blend that it, even though you may be doing it predominantly by yourself, then actually it leverages others as well. So I mentioned that we'll be offering, going live this week, Coursera to all of our associates. So I recently personally completed a program on there. So it wasn't coding, but there would be ones, courses on that platform that probably include coding. And on that, it's a mixture of videos that can be accessed through the computer, or I did a lot of it through the mobile phone, so I could do it while traveling or do it in the gym, etc., watching these videos. You then do assignments, and so those assignments are done by yourself, but then the assignment goes to other learners who then peer review those assignments and provide you feedback. And there's also then a forum that goes with the learning program, the way you can ask questions of either the lecturer or the sort of course sponsors or other participants to get support in what you're doing. So even though most of the study is done by yourself, you feel a bit more part of a community because the assignments that you're doing are peer reviewed and you're getting personalized feedback on those. And you're also reviewing and feeding back on other people's assignments. So it feels a little bit more a part of a learning community. So I think it is possible to do it entirely through self-study. You probably need to have a stronger motivation in order to do that if you don't have some of those peer elements and social reinforcement around it. But some of these programs now and course areas available, if you're an individual outside of a company, you can sign up and get access to that on a subscription basis, and you'll get access to all of those resources, including those community elements.
Can you elaborate on the gaming elements that you mentioned?
Yeah, so and the gamification, I guess, rather than gaming. So the principle around gamification, I guess, is that you perform tasks to get reward. The reward in this case is the badges. So we have these digital badges. So the first badge is a fast track badge. You need to watch 4 videos, spend about 20 minutes in the platform in order to get that fast track badge. That earns you your first one. And then the further badges are done through working through the content in those areas and successfully passing a quiz to a certain pass mark that unlocks the further badges. So you don't have to have completed all the content, but without completing the content, you'll probably find it difficult in order to complete the quiz. And if you try the quiz and fail it, you'll get then feedback on that may help you then the next time you go through it in order to be able to actually successfully pass it. So that element around performing a task and getting your reward through the badge, and then working through, then you've got one badge, so you want 2 badges, and then you want 3 badges, and then you may as well now get all 6 badges so you can get your and unlock your digital champions badge, provided a very strong motivation for people to work through the content. And also then running internal championships, I guess, around particular areas of the business. Said, across these 15 countries where all of our people are sat, who can earn the most badges over the next week period, and running some little championships like that also proved a great way of motivating people to go and take part in the learning and get the reward of the badges or the recognition from being the country that had earned the most badges over that period. So when we talk about gamification, that's how we've used it in this instance.
And several people have asked, are the credentials that you gain recognized externally?
Not explicitly. It may be people start to place value upon being an Novartis Digital Champion. It's not currently tied to any university accreditation or anything like that, but it is a symbol of a certain level of digital awareness that has been earned from being within the company. And we've certainly seen people sharing it through social media, sharing it through their email footers. It may be people start to put it on their CVs to say, I'm an Novartis Digital Champion. I don't know if that's the case, and I don't know whether anyone else would recognize that, but ultimately it's a nice thing for people to be able to have as a recognition that they've put in the effort to understand the basics around digital awareness.
And I think I'll make this the kind of final question. There's I think is a little bit of uncertainty about what is accessible of this within Novartis that's accessible externally as well. So perhaps you could just clarify that.
So of the solutions, the vast majority are internal. Let me just our communities of practice are internal, the awareness hub is, the things like Coursera would be available to someone on a personal level. So Coursera.org is the site, and you can sign up and have a personal subscription to that. The Skillsoft things I don't think are available directly as an individual, but there will be other catalogues of learning like that that one will be able to partake. Through the Digital Awareness Hub, we do reference things like YouTube and things like that. So those would obviously be accessible externally. So I think we have blockchain videos that exist on YouTube and things that, that we've incorporated because they tell the story very well. So why recreate that? Our Learning Month was an internally focused event. We did have external people speaking, but it's for Novartis associates, and the digital immersion is targeted at our internal managers and leaders. So a lot of this is around, you know, how we build the capability within the organization, but you know, many of the broader generic resources like Coursera and things are available. I think the Microsoft MOOC that I referenced, the 300 to 400 hours, I think that's available through edX, as it's the Microsoft Data Science MOOC, about $1,000 I think is the cost as an individual to go through that. So yeah, a mix. Some would be available to someone on an individual basis, but anything where it's, you know, our Novartis messaging, that's targeting our internal 100,000 associates.
Okay, so we're coming very close up to our time. So we've had a huge number of questions. I wish I could go through them all. So I think I'll say thank you very much, Simon, for a fantastic, packed full webinar and a great way to finish this series as well. So thank you very much, Simon, and thank you for everyone who attended and submitted questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Claire. Yeah, and thanks everyone for joining.